Good afternoon, and welcome to the celebration of the life of Sandy Dawson. I'm Sandy's brother, Angus. And one of the great ironies of life, we're going to start on time. Yesterday, just upstairs in the new Cranbrook Chapel, Sandy's wife, Alex, organised a beautiful family funeral where Sandy's kids spoke beautifully about their dad, how much they loved him and knew that he loved them, and how Alex has been their rock, especially over the last 2 years when Sandy was sick. So today is an opportunity to celebrate Sandy's life with all of you, his friends from school, university, life at large, and his many friends and colleagues from the law. It's awful beyond words that Sandy got cancer and died. We have plenty of years to be sad about that, and we will. But today, let's laugh, let's cry, and let's remember him fondly. We will all learn a bit more about him too, as we hear about each part of his life. So Mum and Dad will get us started in just a minute. Then we'll hear from the eldest of his children, Jack. We're then going to hear from Josh Kirton, who's one of Sandy's best mates from Cranbrook days, and Declan Roche, one of his best mates from the law. Sarah Standen, one of Sandy's friends from university, is going to read a poem that's been selected by Alex in a book of poetry that actually Mum gave her. We'll give you another look at the photos during a couple of musical interludes, and then I'll be back right at the end before we sort of head off to have some of Sandy's favourite champagne, some canapes, and of course some ice bobos and Monte Carlos, and I hope everyone will stay and join us. Before we start, a quick thank you to the village that came together to organise today, to the Carinya Strings for the beautiful performances of some of Sandy's favourite pieces, to all those speaking today, a huge thank you, to Josh and Amanda Kirton for arranging such beautiful flowers, to Jay Coutinho, Banco's wonderful clerk, for managing all the RSVPs and helping me chase down countless loose ends. And if you're over 60 and you manage to use the Google form, you are in the minority. To Sandy's oldest mates from school, Ben Austin, Mike Slade, Andrew Howard and Dan Patchett, for being our ushers. And to those of you who sent me so many wonderful photos of Sandy. To my wife, Nikki, for putting together the order of service and being my rock through it all. And my daughter, Sammy, for putting together the photos so beautifully in the slideshow that you're seeing. And to the wonderful team of Nick Sampson, Cameron Torrance, and Melissa Berry at Cranbrook for kindly letting us use this beautiful facility and venue. And all the Cranbrook boys who thought that they'd finished school last week, and instead they're here helping out today beautifully, so thank you. Now, it wouldn't do Sandy justice without kicking off with some inappropriate humour. So I can't resist pointing out that given we're at Cranbrook, it does appear there are a few vacancies coming up on the school council. So if you're interested, there's an application form at the back. But actually, a few people have said that might not be a good idea because we end up with too many lawyers. Okay, with that, I'm going to hand over to Mum and Dad.
Sandy and Angus love their school days here and left school wagging their tails. Our oldest grandson, Sandy's son, Jack, has just finished his HSC here at Cranbrook and was a prefect, talented at all sports except for golf and cricket. It's a bit of a disappointment. He was vice-captain of boats and we're very proud of him. We have three full of beans grandsons here, and they were very sensibly in three different classes. Our thanks also to the wonderful medical staff and nursing staff at Walpa. It takes a very special person to look after people in palliative care. They're amazing.
We're very appreciative and grateful that so many people have come to celebrate Sandy's life with us today, from near and as far as Perth, Brisbane, Darwin, Melbourne and Canberra. So very kind, family, friends, and learned and honourable colleagues.
We were always very proud of Sandy's broad church of friends and immensely grateful for all the beautiful things that have been said about him. Sandy made friends easily, genuinely, and was very loyal. He didn't suffer fools gladly, but they provided a greatly entertaining lot of his stories. Sandy was born nearly 3 weeks late, on the night of the 27th of May, 1972, I woke Sandy Senior up and said, I think we need to go to hospital. And he rolled over and went back to sleep. Sandy had a company car at the time, a beige Holden Kingswood. After a bit more serious urging from me, we rushed to the hospital in the Kingswood, and Sandy was born 1 hour later. This set a pattern for his life. He was nearly always late, arrived in a rush, and developed a deep interest in any car other than a Kingswood. Always traumatised by the close shave of nearly being born in one. Sandy was born with jaundice, two black eyes, bright red hair, and when Sandy Senior saw him wrapped in a clashing King George V bright pink blanket, he nearly fainted. And he said he was exhausted and had to go and play golf.
Golf has continued to play a very important part in our lives, and for Sandy especially, and for as long as his cancer allowed, it helped and was a great distraction. He played and practiced with determination.
He was the most placid, happy baby. He didn't really talk until he was two, and then he came out with complete sentences, an early sign of earning his living by talking and entertaining everyone with his stories and wonderful ability to mimic people from judges, very bravely we thought for his career, to Donald Duck. Singing Silent Night, all in Donald Duck's cartoon voice, was a tour de force. His wicked sense of humour was funny for being self-deprecating. He was a superb raconteur. So many wonderful letters we have received mention that people feel lost for words. Sandy was never lost for words. It was extra sad that towards the end of his life, despite his best efforts, he was unable to speak. Sandy was incredibly kind and had a true dislike of injustice from a very, very early age. We thought having three kids who all studied law would be handy, but the advice from them was always, don't go to court, and made for very vibrant dinner table discussions. Sometimes they needed to be reminded that we aren't in court now. We've been sent some wonderful stories about Sandy's kindness and support for people going through serious challenges in their lives.
After Sandy finished his degree, he and we thought his plan to go backpacking for a while would be a great life lesson.
However, his idea of backpacking was just carrying his luggage on his back. He didn't read the chapter on accommodation and always met someone he charmed and chatted to who offered to have him stay and feed and entertain him.
As Janie said, Sandy was great at impersonations. Peter Graham asked Sandy to his chambers to celebrate him becoming a judge. In front of all present, including judges and leading silks, Peter asked Sandy to do his Bob Hawke imitation. Sandy kept refusing until Peter announced to everyone that Sandy would be doing his Bob Hawke imitation. That he came with, well, mate, I wouldn't have bloody appointed you. Outside the law, three of Sandy's greatest interests were skiing, wine and golf, probably in that order. Oh, and cars.
Sandy was a beautiful skier, elegant, fast, neat and seemingly effortless. All three of our children did the ski instructors course in Canada, which meant we got a lot of advice. Their own families happily loved skiing. Our family skiing holidays were just the best ever.
He had a wonderful wine cellar in the basement of his house. He offered us the use of some of his spare capacity, an offer we never took up because of the likelihood of some of the better bottles going missing. He actually had a very good golf swing, particularly when he slowed it down to a blur. When he had to retire from the law, he started taking up golf as a passion. I had some wonderful golf trips with Sandy and Angus, both individually and the three of us together. Sandy and I had a wonderful trip to Ireland, where we played many of the top courses. It was good for his golf, but also for perfecting his Irish accent. The three of us had one trip to California, and we all played Cypress Point together. The 16th hole at Cypress Point is probably the most famous par three in the world. It's 230 yards long, and 200 yards of that is over the Pacific Ocean, crashing onto the rocks below. On one round, Sandy drove his ball about 3 feet from the hole and calmly sank the putt, almost totally unaware of what he'd just achieved, until his caddy said, "Wow, any of the professional golfers in the US Tour would love to have done that." Angus once claimed that Sandy had more cars than demerit points on his driver's license. He was always mad keen on European cars. He once wrote a letter to Janie when she was overseas in France. After explaining how he was going in his school exams, he wrote, "The James Hardy 1000 was on over the weekend. It was really good. The Goss Jaguar XJS won, a BMW 635 CSI second, and another Jag came in third. It looked like Brock might win, even though his front and back windscreens were out. Goss, the winner in the Jag, was driving well, because his seat had come loose, but he still hit speeds of up to 260 kilometres per hour, bracket, 160 miles per hour for the dummies, close bracket, on Conrod Strait. Janie had absolutely no interest in cars except for their colour or car racing. When Sandy was about 13, he knew I was getting a new car. We used to go to the motor show together, and he was always keen to give advice. He was horrified when I said that I wanted to get a Brock Commodore with a large spoiler at the back and GT stripes down the side. I enumerated all its advantages over nearly anything else, particularly its top speed and how fast it was from 0 to 100. He tried to enlist Angus and Katrina to persuade me against it. This went on for a couple of weeks until the BMW mercifully arrived. He could be quite amusing in court, and I'm sure you've probably read the wonderful tribute by Declan Roche in the Sydney Morning Herald and his comment to Justice Lucy McCullum. For those of you who did not read it, it's worth repeating. Justice McCullum stated that she was considering one of Sandy's legal arguments while she was looking for a school tunic that morning. Sandy quickly commented, "I think what Your Honour is wearing now is a far more appropriate choice." Justice McCullum sent Sandy a framed copy of the transcript. I remember getting a call from the Honourable Peter Graham, before whom Sandy had been appearing. Sandy had handed up a document prepared by his instructing solicitor. Peter then criticised Sandy's Cranbrook schooling and pointed out a number of grammatical errors. Eventually Sandy asked, "Does Your Honour run drafting classes at 9:30 every Friday morning?" Peter was highly amused and rang me to tell me what had been said. We were very proud when Sandy took silk. He was anxious about the move, and he and I had a few discussions about it. Sandy had developed a successful practice and was worried that having to have a junior barrister involved in his cases would make him too expensive for many clients. He needn't have worried.
We were extremely grateful for the way Sandy helped us manage through the events following Katrina's death. From managing the media coverage to guiding us through the interminable inquest.
And its many frustrations.
At Cranbrook, both Sandy and Angus were captains of debate. We spent endless hours travelling to schools far, far away to listen to topics like "It's just not cricket anymore," which somehow translated an argument for world peace. The Amazon and holes in the ozone layer was a good introduction to arguing a point of law.
Sandy was in a club debate and had to follow Justice Roddy Marr. He probably went a bit too far, and so finished with, "And I trust that Justice Marr will forget everything I said tonight when I next appear before him." From all the debates Janie and I attended, we knew that each speaker was actually supposed to address the topic. We were at one club debate where the topic of something to do with sportsmanship became totally irrelevant. Sandy was up against a dear friend of ours, a well-known lawyer who enjoyed speaking roles, with the Christian name of Ivan. For 5 minutes, possibly even longer, Sandy spoke in a heavy Russian accent, praising someone called Ivan, for Russian athletes all cheating by taking drugs, for the Russian oligarchs stealing Russia's assets, for the Russian government bribing officials to get the Olympics, for the murder of Russian citizens when they were in other countries. The list went on and on. This poor guy, Ivan, had no real reply because Sandy hadn't made any points, even vaguely related to the topic.
Afterwards, Ivan's wife said to Ivan, "I never want to go to court without Sandy Dawson." We have wonderful memories of great family holidays without the modern day intrusion of social media, and when travelling was an exciting adventure and not an anxious time of hoping your luggage had adventured with you instead of without you. After many years, we were able to turn left on entering the aeroplane, and the kids would have to turn right. Sandy, the younger, would be immaculately attired in jacket and tie and bid us an emotional farewell on the hope of the staff upgrading him, always unsuccessful. Perhaps because Angus and Katrina, in their daggy trackies, rather ruined the image.
He used to regale us with anecdotes about some of his defamation courtroom battles with Clive Evatt, including a perfect imitation of Clive's voice. He was so appreciated by Clive that Sandy was asked to speak at Clive's funeral.
Much has been said about his immaculate appearance, his suits, his ties, matching handkerchief, and while still living at home, he would often send Sandy Senior back upstairs to change his clothes. "Dad, seriously? How could you wear all that together?" And after he lived in St. Paul's College, sort of studying for his arts law degree, it became, "How can you let Dad wear that one? It's criminal." We gave Sandy and Angus an ironing board each and an iron to try and train them to be good husbands one day. Sandy ironed his shirts and Angus used his iron to hammer a nail in the wall to
It wasn't just Janie whom he criticised for whatever clothes I was wearing. I remember dutifully going to one of his school soccer matches, resplendently attired in caramel corduroy trousers with a white skivvy, a tan leather jacket and brown shoes. It turned out that I wasn't resplendently attired at all, as Sandy made very clear, not wanting any of his teammates to identify me as having anything to do with him.
Sandy was so much more than a car fanatic and a fashion critic. Sandy was obviously much loved by his friends and family, whom he adored, and much admired by a cross-section of a great number of people.
The tributes from the Chief Justice, from the President of the New South Wales Bar, from his colleague Declan Roche, who will speak later, and media personalities like Ray Hadley and Sarah Ferguson were very moving and greatly appreciated. Sandy spent 15 years as Chairman of the Woollahra Zone of the Salvation Army Red Shield Appeal. Every year he would address the school assembly, and over 100 Cranbrook and Scots boys would volunteer to be his collectors.
It was very special for us that our three wonderful kids were so close, that the boys, as we referred to Sandy and Angus, were each other's best men at their beautiful weddings. The kids were always telling us how lucky we were to have them. No big challenges from them growing up, etc. And we agree. We are blessed to have had Sandy, Katrina and Angus in our lives and their wonderful families. Words can't describe how amazing how amazing and caring Angus has been on so many levels. And through this awful sadness of Sandy's illness, he too has been our rock. We have 9 incredibly precious grandchildren whose lives have been deeply affected by Katrina's death and now Sandy's. The ripple effect of these unfathomable tragedies on many lives is widespread and deeply felt. Close family, friends and friendships keep us strong. As the old adage, that time heals, is sadly not true. Going through photos for this celebration has been both sad for what we have lost, but so appreciative for what we were so lucky to have. Cherish every moment. Life can be very short.
We always knew what the outcome of Sandy's brain cancer would be. However, when it happened, it was tough to deal with the finality of it. It's doubly tough to deal with the death of 2 incredible children. Peter Thompson is Australia's greatest ever golfer, who won 5 British Open Championships. He was once asked what does golf teach you about life? Peter's reply, succinct as always, was, play the ball as it lies. That's about it. And that's how we're trying to manage through what's happened.
Thank you. Good morning, family and friends. Thank you so much for coming today. My name is Declan Roche, and I'm the eldest son of Sandy Dawson. My dad, Alexander Tamerlane Sinclair Dawson, was born on the 27th of May, 1972. He was introduced to Sandy, but also affectionately known as Sandos, Uncle Sandy, or Your Prominence. His favourite colour was blue, his favourite movie was Star Wars, The Empire Strikes Back. His favourite spaceship was the Millennium Falcon. His favourite beer was Corona. His favourite wine was red, preferred silver over gold, and always wore a handkerchief. He was a brother to his two siblings, Angus and Katrina. He grew up in Cranbrook, in the east of Sydney, attending school here at Cranbrook, where he excelled academically, but not so much sportingly.
Being drafted in the C-grade soccer team in Year 7, only to be dropped days later after mistaking his coach's bare shins for a soccer ball. After graduating Cranbrook, Sandy was accepted into the St. Paul's College at Sydney University, where in his second year met a young Sancta Sophia resident by the name of Alexandra Hunter during an intercollegiate production of Michael Gow's Away, where Sandy awkwardly played the role of Alex's father. Sandy's pursuit of Alexandra was a success, leading to a beautiful wedding on the 15th of April 2000, where the priest jumbled the names of the groom and bride, saying, "Do you, Alexander, take you, Sandy?" which effectively married my dad to himself. This marriage lasted 22 years and saw the birth of four wonderful children. In 2004, the eldest son was born, Jack Alexander Forster Dawson, preceding myself 2.5 years later. The twins, Holly Alexandra Dawson and Freya Victoria Dawson, were born in December. Seeming to follow some sort of trend, young Henry Hunter Dawson arrived on the 6th of June 2008, the same date as my birthday, but 4 years later. That resolved the total family members to 6, with only 4 birthday celebrations needed per year. Although, if you count our puppies, that makes 8 family members with only 5 birthdays. The puppies were instantly part of the family, wanted by my dad and cared for by my mum. This piled up the plate even higher for my mum, having to deal with 4 kids, 2 dogs, a full-time job, housework, and a sick husband. Through all of it, my mum was a rock for the family. Outside of the courtroom, my dad was an enthusiastic member of the Royal Sydney Golf Club, relishing his time on the golf course right up until his final months. Although his children never really got into golfing, I have fond memories of our ski trips at Thredbo and then eventually overseas. Our overseas adventures began at the end of 2013 with a trip to Beaver Creek in Colorado, after Henry had been institutionalized in kindergarten, learning how to sit on a chair. This trip still proved difficult for the 5-year-old, losing his iPad, headphones, blanket, travel pillow, carry-on luggage, and left sock. However, a more pressing issue for us children was the overly obnoxious manner in which our father emotively vocalized his enjoyment of the in-flight entertainment. This drove us mad as we began to think that the whole flight hated our family. Looking back, however, the irritated stares were most likely because of our inability to find comfort in an airplane seat, combined with our excessively verbal complaint array. Arriving in Beaver Creek just in time to see the fireworks, the next day, Dad introduced us to a type of snow called powder. This was seemingly unknown to our Australian eyes, as the four of us struggled to adapt to the lack of ice and dirt on American slopes. "This isn't like back home," Holly pointed out, as Henry told his father that he was stuck for the third time that run. I have a fond memory of Holly, Henry, Dad, and me tackling the Grouse Mountain on our final day of skiing in Beaver Creek to top off our first international ski trip. Although his lack of sporting prowess was mentioned before, my dad proved to be a world-class skier, at least in my opinion, holding the record for least number of falls, yet greatest toll of injury. The suffered rotator cuff tear did not, however, stop him from recovering and excelling in the weights gym, flaunting an impressively high number of repetitions while bench pressing more than his body weight. My earliest memory of my dad was staying up late with him on school nights to watch the original Star Wars movies. My dad sparked my love for Star Wars, and I loved watching all the new shows with him. His Darth Vader impression was unmatched. For some reason, every time I've seen those photos of him in the newspaper, walking down Martin Place, I'm sure a lot of you have seen those, I always associate it with the Imperial March music. So that's the one when Darth Vader comes in, it goes, dun, 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 right. Not because he's evil, okay, but just because of the presence that I sort of sense when he's walking down it with his band of legal accomplices behind him. If he was someone in Star Wars, I think he would have been a Jedi Master on the High Council. He would have had a blue lightsaber with a single silver hilt, and he would have worn black Jedi robes. Star Wars was actually a prominent dinner conversation in the family when our manners weren't being reprimanded. Us four kids would seek thrill out of annoying Dad by breaking every manners rule in the book. My personal favourites were elbows on the table and holding my cutlery with my fists. To show our appreciation and to be polite, our dad insisted for us to say, "Thank you, I've had an elegant sufficiency," before we would excuse ourselves from the table after finishing our meal. Instead, us children decided to say, "Elephant deficiency," just to push his buttons even more. He eventually came around to it and incorporated it into his own vocabulary soon after. Family dinner was always a thrill when Dad had a story to tell from work, my favourite topic being the intelligent and witty lambasting he would give to lying witnesses in the box. He would notoriously rip them to shreds. The dinner table would not, however, be his only audience for stories, frequently finding himself on the sidelines of Saturday sport games, chatting with other fathers more than watching the actual game. This didn't matter though, because he would always, without fail, take us to get a Powerade and sausage roll afterwards, or alternatively, a hot chockey and a bacon and egg roll on the colder Saturday mornings. Those were the second best types of breakfast I shared with my dad, the best ones being homemade French toast on a Sunday morning. Since then, I've developed my own take on the infamous Sandy French toast, adding a lot more butter and a hint of cinnamon. The best memories with my dad seemed to be the little ones. It was cooking steaks, eating bacon and eggs, skiing, talking about Star Wars, going to the gym, drinking protein shakes, talking about cars, or listening to his Darth Vader impressions. A memory that will always be with me is when he used to write little post-it notes of things I used to like. For example, he would draw the infinity symbol on a little post-it note and stick them to the head of my bed. This represented our favourite Buzz Lightyear quote, "To infinity and beyond," from Toy Story. He would then, stick it on a bed and it would remind me how much he loved me and how much I loved him. Those of you who know my family know that my siblings and I can be an absolute nightmare. This would especially be displayed on our driving holidays around Australia. My dad would be driving up the front of our Land Cruiser, Mum in the passenger seat, and the four of us kids scattered through the back of the car with the luggage, blankets, pillows, and iPad chargers. These long drives would have us screaming, crying, belting each other with pillows, punching, kicking, and squealing. I even remember trying to choke Henry with a blanket over his face. No matter what was going on in the back, Dad's driving would remain unfazed and would always get us to our destination. Now, before I finish, I just wanted to draw attention to someone who doesn't nearly get enough praise. I know this is supposed to be about my dad, but I know that he won't mind me talking about his better half for a moment. The most impressive thing about my mum is her resilience. Resilience to fatigue, resilience to anger, and resilience to the odds being against her. My dad is the second most humble person you'll ever meet, second only to my mum. Even with every reason to leave, she stayed, right by his side up until he passed. The sacrifices she has made for her family, most oftentimes at the expense of her own well-being, are immeasurable to any other human fate. If I had one word to describe her, it would be undefeatable, unable to be defeated. My mum, Alexandra Hunter, is by far the strongest person on the planet, and she gets nowhere near the amount of recognition she deserves. My mum taught me that the most important thing in life is to be a good person, even if no one knows, to rise above pettiness, rise above jealousy, and rise above hatred, to accept others for who they are and who are not as fortunate as you. I stand by that, and I know my father did too. Mum, on behalf of Holly, Freya, Henry, and Dad, I want to thank you for your kindness and strength. We appreciate it more than you will ever know. You didn't deserve what has happened. You deserve so much more. I love you, Mum, and you didn't deserve any of this. Getting back on track. Going down in history, affectionately known as the best defamation lawyer in the Southern Hemisphere, Sandy's influence and legacy on the bar and defamation law is unbeatable by any contender. I knew him as the hardest working man in the world, proven by his success in the courtroom, but similarly demonstrated by his face of emotive determination and grit while under a barbell in the gym. My dad has made me the man I am today and the man that I will continue to be for the rest of my life. Sandy fought to his last breath and would never give up. Thus, all good things must come to an end. As Master Yoda said, death is a natural part of life. Rejoice for those around you who transform into the Force. I like to think my dad is part of the Force now, guiding and helping us. He's always there. Sandy was a brother, an uncle, a son, a husband, a friend, a cousin, a client, a barrister, a barista, a senior counsel, a wannabe Jedi, a skier, a gym bro, a listener, a golfer, a wordsmith, a realist, a driver, a gentleman. But most importantly, he was my dad, and a mighty fine one, if I do say so myself. Thank you for everything, Dad. Thank you for teaching me how to have a strong handshake. Thank you for teaching me how to tie a tie and to fold a handkerchief. Thank you for motivating me in the gym. Thank you for coming to my sport games. I love you, Dad.
Well, Jack, that was amazing, and thank you. You're a remarkable man, and Sandy absolutely adored you, Holly, Freya, and Henry, and was incredibly proud of all of you. And he would have been bursting with pride today to listen to those words. Sandy, too, was a remarkable man, and I was incredibly lucky to have him as my big brother. We were born only 14 months apart, and navigated the roller coaster of life together through Cranbrook, through St Paul's College, and through Sydney Uni Law School. Over most of the last decade, we would see each other, often twice a week, at 5:30 a.m. in Queen's Park to exercise. And I was lucky to spend a lot of time with him over the last 2 years while he was sick and battling his cancer. We have lots of great friends in common, and Sandy and I loved seeing his youngest Henry, my son Tom, and Katrina and Paul's son Ollie become great mates. Katrina was born 3 years after me, and we were all very close growing up. She would also join our exercise sessions in Queen's Park and put us boys to shame. Sandy adored and admired her, and he loved being at the bar with her. Her death was incredibly painful for him, and it haunted him that he hadn't spent more time with him across their busy lives. And of course, his work at the bar and his chambers in Martin Place, just up from the Limp Cafe, brought a vivid and daily reminder of her, which affected him deeply for a number of years. Katrina was very keen for Sandy to take Silk and spend a long time trying to talk him into it. She would have been so proud of him when he did and see him thrive as his prominence. There are so many things I could tell you about my brother, but I thought I'd share a few things about what it was like growing up with him as my brother. We all know that Sandy loved the finer things in life. Seriously, Mum and Dad, if you name a kid Alexander Tamerlane Sinclair Dawson, you're not getting jeans and t-shirt kind of guy. When Sandy was 15, he went to Hong Kong to stay with a school friend, and he relished the mysticism and magic of Hong Kong. And by that, I mean bespoke tailors. I kid you not, he had 13 pairs of trousers made. 15 years old, every shade you could think of. And he would pack at least 8 of these every time he went on holiday, filling his own suitcase and also half of the one that Katrina and I would share. But no one can deny here that he had a real sense of style. And he didn't really care what others thought. He was most excited about high school, because it meant he could wear long trousers and never had to wear shorts again. I don't think he ever owned another pair at school. St Paul's College suited him perfectly with a coat and tie, formal dinner every night. And of course, as a barrister with the silly costumes all of you lot wear. I asked him at one point if he was wearing trackies and a t-shirt under his robes. He wasn't. Although COVID and working over Zoom finally broke him with his finery on top and shorts underneath. He did make it his mission to get me to dress properly. He would take me with him to his tailors, to his glasses shop, and he would regularly buy me clothes for gifts. I only finally bought my first suits without consulting him a few years ago and was beyond relieved when he approved. And I bought my first eyeglasses only last week, but from his trusted shop. I both trusted and admired his taste, but I was deeply fearful of his disapproval, having seen Dad sent back upstairs so many times. Today I'm wearing a pocket handkerchief for him. I can confidently say it for the first time in my life. I was fiddling with it outside and struggling to work out how to put it in, and actually Jack came out and helped put it on properly for me. Although he did tell me that it's meant to match the shirt, not the tie. So, Sandy, we've still got work to do. The pocket handkerchief does remind me of one of the favourite stories Sandy would tell. And while many of us were often characters in his stories, he was also typically the one who was most being taken down. And we used to be regaled by them at exercise at 5:30 in the morning on cold mornings, and they were just a great highlight. So one of them related to a pocket handkerchief where I think he was about to go into Rooty Hill local court. He was dressed, well, as Sandy, with a pinstripe suit, perfectly groomed hair, and dramatic shirt, tie, and matching handkerchief in his pocket. One of his colleagues suggested that he might not really fit in. So Sandy, taking this advice very seriously, whipped out the pocket handkerchief with a flourish, put it in his pocket, and strode in, genuinely believing he had now appropriately dressed down. For those of us who are Cranbrook parents and remember year one father-son camp in the Blue Mountains, we will never forget that as most of the lads engaged in an arms race about the size and features of their Eskies, Sandy, Paul and I walked in, all three of us straining under the weight of Sandy's magnificent chrome coffee machine, ignoring all the ribbing and getting happily set up for Sandy to cheerily make about 40 delicious lattes for everyone the next morning. His sense of style extended to his accommodations. He beautifully fitted out his chambers, he fully decorated his room at college. He campaigned actually in first year that it was a basic human right to have a double bed rather than a prison style single bed. And of course, he poured so much into creating beautiful homes for his family in Rutherford Street, in Denison Street, and now Robertson Road. Mum talks about his blazer on the plane, hoping for an upgrade, and Katrina and my trackies sabotaging his otherwise excellent chances. Perhaps feeling remorseful, I used an obscene amount of frequent flyer points to upgrade him all the way from his discount economy to first class when Mum, Dad, Katrina, Sandy and I all met in Scotland in 2014 at St Andrews for Dad's ceremony to take on his captain role of the Royal and Ancient. Sandy and I joined up in Heathrow, and it's fair to say he was a little worse for wear. He explained that after waiting almost 40 years for his upgrade, he had insisted on experiencing every wine and champagne in the business. Most of you have read about or experienced Sandy's brilliant mind. For you, that meant a great colleague. For many, it meant it was impossible to ever win an argument with him. Ever. He was diligent for most of school and was ducks of year 11 at Cranbrook. He then adopted some different study patterns, basically leave things till the last minute until he had very little time and then crank. Basically, he was just conditioning himself for the bar and being able to master a brief at short notice. I was a bit more conscientious as a student, and when he and I ended up at law school together, he was a keen consumer of my notes. This was an arrangement I was perfectly happy with, until he took my international law notes a couple of days before the exam, not ever knowing where the lecture theatre was, and then beat me with a very healthy distinction. His explanation, sorry pal, I thought you would have done much better. I I hazard that a number of you in a strange way who don't know each other may have inadvertently already met care of being characters in one of Sandy's retelling of a great story. At my wife Nikki's 50th, his speech was particularly outrageous, which was the highlight of the night. As one of my friends said to his wife, who was a little offended, when the delivery is that good, you can get away with anything, and he did. But imagine growing up with that. Katrina and I spent long car trips in absolute rapture and laughter, as Sandy created long, elaborate, and hilarious tales of Donald Duck, with the most extraordinary Donald Duck voice, telling of his adventures with Daisy Duck, all PG in those days, of course, and Huey, Dewey, and Louie. And we would pester him to keep going and going and going, no matter how much trouble he was in. He could switch to Donald Duck, or he could get out of any argument or fight. Mum and Dad could never last more than a minute of Donald Duck before giving in and cracking up and losing their focus on whatever they meant to get across with them about. No event was complete without Sandy's alter egos of Darth Vader or John Laws showing up for cameos. And he could pretty much do the entire Billy Birmingham 12th Man album from start to finish, with Anabolic's costume malfunction and the unfortunate Rick Disneck's ruptured spleen and broken ribs. Our family favourite was the way he would sing a Placido Domingo John Denver duet, with all the resonance and impossible to understand lyrics of the operatic tenor, and then by contrast, making John Denver sound like Kermit the Frog. So I'm going to play for you now the original version. Imagine Sandy singing it in his style to Placido and John. I'm sorry, but Sandy's was better, and I'll never forget it.
Perhaps love is like a resting place, a shelter from the storm. It exists to give you comfort, it is there to keep you warm. And in those times of trouble, when you are most alone, the memory of love will bring you home.
Perhaps love is like a window, perhaps an open door. It invites you to come closer, it wants to show you more. And even if you lose yourself and don't know what to do, the memory of love will see you through.
Oh, love to some is like a cloud, to some as strong as steel.
For some a way of living, for some way to feel.
And some say love is holding on, and some say letting go. And some say love is everything, some say they don't know.
Perhaps love is like the ocean, full of conflict, full of pain. Like a fire when it's cold outside, thunder when it rains.
If I live forever and all my dreams come true, my memories of love will be of you. And some say love is holding on, and some say letting go.
And some say love is everything, and some say they don't know. Perhaps love is like the ocean, full of conflict, full of pain. Like a fire when it's cold outside, thunder when it rains.
If I should live forever and all my dreams come true, my memory of love will be of you.
As Sandy began to realise that death was not far away from him, he told Alex that he wanted to be remembered both fondly and often. Alex chose this beautiful poem by the Australian poet Gwen Harwood as it echoes those words of Sandy's. So the light falls, and so it fell on branches leaved with flocking birds. Light stole a city's weight to swell the coloured life of stone. Your words hung weightless in my ear. Remember me. All words except those words were drowned in the fresh babbling rush of spring. In summer's dream-filled light, one sound echoed through all the whispering galleries of green. Remember me. Rods of light point home the flocking starlings to wintry trees and turn stone into golden ochre, locking the orbit of my pain. I learned the weight of light and stone. Remember me.
Somebody said to me that this is going to be hard, and if you put something strange in your pocket, it might make it easier. Well, actually, it wasn't meant to be my keys, but that'll work. So my name's Josh Kirton. I first met Sandy when I started late at Cranbrook in Year 11 back in 1988. Today was always going to be a difficult day, not only because it was hard to capture in words everything that Sandy was and achieved, but also because I was Sandy's quite ineloquent engineering buddy. Public speaking was his role, and on the rare occasion I've been called upon to do so, Sandy was always my most trusted advisor to get it right. I know he would have been here keen to help me work on this speech, and he would have insisted it be far funnier. Our friendship really didn't develop until the end of school, but I was very aware of Sandy's presence from day one. It was hard not to respect someone so charismatic and actively involved in school life. House captain, captain of debating, involved in too many extracurricular activities to list, while still an outstanding academic in the classics. Of many memorable moments, his bravery one day at school assembly stands out. The Cranbrook rowing forward being very successful, culminating in the captain of rowing brandishing his oar in front of the assembled senior school and declaring, "This is my oar," to much roar and approbation. Sandy felt this unfairly diminished the equally successful debating team. So he had the inspired and somewhat brave idea to start his report by holding his pen aloft, a waterman of course, and boldly state, "This is my pen." To much groaning and derision and many cheers, mine included. Our friendship developed due to our shared passion for cars, albeit very humble cars to begin with. Sandy had a safe off-white Volvo 144, replete with sheepskin seat covers. I had a much racier Peugeot 504 diesel. Equally sexy, but importantly, it was a manual. Sandy desperately wanted to learn how to drive a manual, so one clutch plate later, we were firm friends. A very small price to pay. School days ended and uni beckoned. Sandy had excelled in the HSC, gaining entry into Arts Law at Sydney Uni, and he thought it was important to expand his social group from the cloistered environs of the eastern suburbs, private boys' schools. So he enrolled at St Paul's College, where he was able to mix with students from private schools in northern suburbs as well. Sandy embraced college, forming a large group of friends for life. His college room was legendary. Sandy, being Sandy, redecorated and upgraded the furniture, sponge-washed lime walls, four-poster bed, and a fully stocked bar, made him the envy of college. I must admit, I was also envious of all the fun Sandy was having at college, and in the sandstone quarter of the university, while I was stuck in the concrete jungle of the Darlington Engineering campus. But our friendship continued, and I became a regular, if uninvited, guest at Jane and Sandy Senior's beautiful home in Randwick. Jane, an accomplished academic, businesswoman, and artist, and Sandy Senior, one of Australia's leading CEOs, together with Angus and Katrina, with Sandy's formidable intellect dwarfed by his siblings, always a family joke, ensured that dinner table conversations were always engaging and debate robust. It was at one of these dinners that I first saw an example of Sandy's amazing advocacy skills at work. With a line of logic that still eludes me to this day, he convinced Jane and Sandy that the Volvo was simply not safe enough, and the only logical solution was to upgrade to a Toyota Celica sports car. I'm not sure if they were totally convinced, but the Celica arrived. Regardless of rhetoric, the Celica did not turn out to be a safe choice than the Volvo, I think it is fair to say that driving was one area that Sandy was seldom on the right side of the law, or the road for that matter. At this time, Sandy rang me one night to tell me he'd met an amazing Sancta Sophia student. Alex, according to Sandy, was way out of his league, but he was besotted from the moment they met. The interest was not immediately mutual, but Sandy made it his mission to change her mind. Their initial courtship was tempestuous, to say the least, but from this fire, they forged a life-changing partnership. Alex was the love of his life and perfect partner in all things. While academically gifted, study was probably not Sandy's primary focus at uni, with interesting diversions into college and student politics, plays and other pursuits taking up much of his time. His studies extended beyond the usual 5 years for arts law. In spite of, or perhaps because of this, when he finally graduated, he managed to secure a coveted position as an associate to Federal Court Judge Graham Hill. A true friendship is not tested until you've had at least one great argument. We explored this when Sandy travelled to Brisbane for a trial, and I had the opportunity to meet Justice Hill after court. Being an ignorant engineer, I greeted him by his first name. Sandy was horrified and admonished me severely afterwards for not using the correct salutation of judge. I was not suitably chastened, refusing to pander to what I saw as a slightly anachronistic pomposity, but Sandy viewed as respect and gratitude for a life of service. We argued about this for days, never to be resolved, but eventually forgiven. A very helpful element in any great friendship is when your partners are also great friends. Sandy and Alex were the first people I called when Amanda and I became engaged in London. When we returned to Sydney, Amanda and Alex formed an instant bond, perhaps because they had a shared experience in managing difficult men. Our families grew. Alex and Sandy became godparents to our firstborn, Daisy. Sandy took his godfather duties seriously. One Christmas, he made the mistake of giving her a doctor's set. Daisy took to her new role with relish, demanding he submit to treatment. "Lie down and close your eyes, Sandy. This is going to hurt." A less devoted godparent may have balked, not Sandy. Sandy and Alex joined us on their parenting journey soon after, quickly catching up with our three with the arrival of Jack, our godson, Holly and Freya, although twins is cheating a little, and then leapfrogging us with Henry. Henry's arrival was a final straw in our stalemate about having a fourth child, and so a compromise was reached. I gave in. And we joined them in all the mayhem and joy that having a big family brings. A chaotic and much-loved annual tradition was our joint family trips to Thredbo, where we stayed at the Three Bears, two little cottages side by side. Sandy was a devoted and beautiful skier. Some of my fondest memories of trying to keep up with him as he effortlessly nailed the bumps under the bluff, knees a blur of controlled fury, his impeccable, well-coiffed mane of red hair annoyingly unmoving regardless of the terrain, his outfit of choice, a spectacular metallic purple and bronze spider one piece from the 1980s. Luckily, he could ski. A devoted skier, his priority, however, was always ensuring Jack, Holly, Freya, and Henry were ready for a day on the slopes, getting them to ski school on time, mostly, while managing the numerous missing gloves, goggles, helmets, skis, and poles with love and a degree of patience. This care, attention, and joy in his children was present in everything he did with them. Family holidays, shared birthday dinners, and our annual Dawson-Kirton Xmas lunch. We actually called it the Dirton lunch, so I always stumble on that one. All kept our friendship strong, with many good and some very dark times shared. One of my great regrets is that I never saw Sandy in court. He did, however, kindly present on defamation law for an event I had organised for a group of CEOs. Sandy went to great lengths to arrange this for us to take place in the ceremonial federal court, adding a slide deck to increase gravitas. This resulted in Sandy and I doing a comedic routine as we tried to get his laptop connected to the court's AV. The slide deck abandoned, Sandy started to talk off the cuff, captivating the room with story after story of famous Pyrrhic victories in defamation. It wasn't a great sales pitch for the legal system, the key takeaway being that if you're thinking about going to court, please just buy him a Porsche. A far less painful, faster, and better outcome for all. Sandy's diagnosis hit us hard, but he approached it with his usual positive and determined manner, refusing to give in to negative thoughts and ensuring he did everything to maximise his chances of successfully beating the disease. One positive that I took was that for the first time, he had free time. I greedily took advantage of this, and we both rediscovered our love of golf. It was a special time spent walking down fairways together on the rare occasion that we both middled our drives, chatting about our troubles and joys, and berating each other's golfing abilities mercilessly. We discussed his concerns that his love of the law had resulted in too heavy a price on his time. He always prioritised his family, but his success as a barrister required regular long nights and weekends. We wondered what else he could have done to fulfil his career. A natural performer and mimic, he would have made a great late-night TV host. He always had a secret desire to replace Brian Henderson as the Channel 9 newsreader. He would have excelled in all, but the law was his true passion. With Sandy's passing, some of the pain has been eased by the many wonderful tributes from his colleagues and clients, recognising his impact on them, the media and the law, many positing that he would have been eventually appointed to the bench. I don't think he would have accepted, as he loved being a barrister, but if he had, it would have been my great honour to call my great friend Judge.
We're now going to have another musical interlude. The strings are going to play Pachelbel's Canon while we see our sort of last go through of the photos. This was a piece Sandy loved, and it's what Alex played for him at the end.
Thank you. Sandy loved being a barrister. As his old friend Kate Richardson pointed out this week, you only had to look at all those photos of him entering and leaving court to see that this was a man in his element. Whereas most of us arrive juggling folders, feeling and sometimes looking stressed and dishevelled, Sandy would sweep into court, dressed immaculately, carrying nothing more than a notebook. I met Sandy in 2009 when I started as a barrister at Banco Chambers. By this stage, Sandy had only actually been at the bar for about 5 years, but from his demeanour and practice, it seemed that he'd been a barrister for much longer. He also seemed much older than me. In fact, he was only 18 months older. For Sandy, no case was too big or too small. In our first case together, we acted for the president of a Kung Fu Federation in defamation proceedings relating to an online martial arts magazine. Although disappointingly, the decision was never reported. I'm pleased to say we were successful, including obtaining nominal damages of $10. As I said to Sandy when we got the judgment, I'd never appreciated the nominal damages were quite so nominal. I went on to do much bigger cases with Sandy, but whatever the size of the case, the method was the same. He made sure he knew the law inside out, he would comb through the facts, and he was determined to win. Now, as we all know, Sandy was a leader in defamation law. It was as if this area of law had in fact been invented for Sandy. Frequent trips to court, juries to charm and persuade, a succession of memorable clients and opponents, all with constant media coverage. Sandy mostly acted for defendants, but he also on occasions acted for plaintiffs in defamation. But regardless of the client, he always showed them the same care and concern. Everyone has spoken about Sandy's sense of humour. How could you not? And he was extremely funny. But what was extraordinary was the way that that humour permeated every aspect of his life. There was rarely an interaction with Sandy that did not produce a laugh. And it was important to his work. There were the funny moments in court that we've heard about. But more importantly, out of court, during the often long slog of preparing cases, his humour kept everyone going. Tom Blackburn, who frequently led Sandy as a junior, described his humour the other day as irrepressible and at times almost anarchic. Tom recalls working late one night with Sandy for a trial the next day. Tom told me, "We were both tired, but there was a lot of work to be done." Sandy began reading out passages from law reports in the voices of various well-known public figures. It was quite surreal having some dry point of law read out to you by John Laws. Tom says it worked. Their spirits revived. They both attacked the case with renewed vigour. Now, voices were an integral part of Sandy's impersonations, but it wasn't just the voices. Sandy would embody the people he impersonated. He would mimic how someone pursed their lips when they were angry, or shuffled down a corridor, or fiddled with their tie when they spoke. Of course, it followed that Sandy would immediately notice if there was something different about you. It might be a new haircut, not so much in my case, or a new item of clothing. I remember once my wife gave me a lovely work bag as a Christmas gift. It was a canvas bag made of a rugged twill. My wife had gone to some trouble to find it after I'd admired it in a movie. I was very proud of it. I'd searched for the perfect bag for many years and finally I felt I had found it. Shortly after receiving the bag, I walked into Standy's chambers for a conference. He looked at me, looked at the bag and asked, "Going camping, are we?" The bag did not appear again. Of course, this ability to observe people closely came in very handy in cases. Sandy was a skillful cross-examiner. And one of the reasons he was such a good cross-examiner was that he paid close attention to people. He knew when to press a witness, and he knew when a witness might be encouraged to make an admission. In one of his final cases in the Federal Court in Melbourne, he obtained a crucial admission from a witness with a short series of questions which began with, "You've been thinking about that email over lunch, haven't you, Mr. Stewart?" While Sandy worked cases hard, he rarely let it become personal. He was unfailingly courteous and maintained cordial, if not friendly, relationships with his opponents, even under the most trying of circumstances. As Sandy Senior said, he was asked to speak at Clive Evatt QC's funeral. And Will, Clive's son Will, called me this week to express his gratitude. It has to be remembered that Clive used to drive Sandy crazy in court. But Will said that Sandy accepted not one but two invitations to speak at different memorial services in Clive's honour. That was Sandy. Few people will feel the loss of Sandy more keenly than Sydney's tailors. He was, as one close barrister friend remarked, the Imelda Marcos of ties. Sandy loved becoming a silk in 2016, partly for the recognition it represented, partly for the opportunities it afforded him, and partly because he just loved the new robes. He spent an inordinate amount of time selecting the perfect weight of silk, thin enough for the heat of summer, but with just the right amount of heft. And he wasn't happy with the quality of bar jacket that was commercially available at that time in Sydney, so he went to his own tailor and asked him to design one. Many silks from Banco have since gone back to that tailor to buy what is now known as the Sandy bar jacket. In preparing to speak today, I wanted to speak to people who knew Sandy well. As part of that process, I naturally had to call his mechanic Rob. Rob told me that Sandy started coming to his workshop in the early 1990s, when Sandy had a 1986 5 Series BMW, which, when you think about it now, is an absurdly large and expensive car for a man still in his 20s. I think we saw it earlier. Rob said the car had a persistent vibrating noise in the steering column that no one had been able to fix. Rob said he and Sandy had a long call about the noise. At the end of the call, Sandy was convinced and said he would drop the car to Rob, notwithstanding that Rob's garage was in Hornsby Heights and Sandy lived on the other side of the world in the eastern suburbs. Anyway, Rob fixed the noise and Sandy became Rob's most loyal and favourite customer. Rob told me that Sandy used to deliver the car and pick it up out of hours. So it was about a year before Rob actually met him face to face. Rob said, "I remember being surprised at how young he was. With his rich voice and refined speech, I had envisaged someone considerably older." Sandy's meticulous preparation of cases meant that he would have long conferences during the day and then work late into the night. He was inexhaustible. The same could not be said for his juniors. We were often exhausted. However, one of the compensations for being Sandy's junior was the excellent catering. In recent days, his juniors have taken some comfort from reciting the many regular orders that Sandy would make at periodic intervals during the day. Spanakopita from Legal Grounds, sushi and miso soup from the David Jones Food Hall, buttered hot cross buns when they're in season, 3-quarter flat whites, always 3-quarters, and after a long day in court, a round of affogatos, all organised by the ever-patient and ever-attentive Catherine. Cases with Sandy could be tough on the waistline. During a case, he once invited me for dinner at the Australian Club. It was late and the club was quiet. We both ordered steak. As our meals arrived, a waiter in a jacket, came to our table holding a silver platter full of condiments. I'd never seen a selection of condiments like it. I happily picked up one of the little silver mustard boats and put it next to my plate. The waiter went rigid. Sandy looked horrified. And then he immediately started to apologise on my behalf. Little did I realise that one was meant to spoon out a little bit of the desired condiment rather than take the whole boat. I think Sandy eventually forgave me, although come to think of it, he never invited me back. And we went back to having sushi in his chambers with those little packets of soy sauce. Sandy's chambers were always a hive of activity. Sandy would swivel between his conference table and his desk, where he had an ever-increasing bank of computer screens, on which he kept thousands of documents open. He didn't believe in closing documents. Seated in his high-back chair, with his Bluetooth earpiece in, he looked more like a banker at times than a barrister. His conference table was always overflowing with papers, fountain pens, bottles of wine that had been given as gifts, and a bottomless bowl of mints. Sandy had his own unique relationship with time. Scientists have spent decades studying whether it's possible to bend time. For most of us, that's a very abstract concept, but Sandy attempted it on a daily basis. He was always running late, including to court. One of his juniors recently described to me the sickening experience of being in the lift on the way up to court and looking at the clock in the lift click past 10:15 a.m. But Sandy would always turn around and say, "Don't worry, these clocks run fast." One of the aspects of Sandy's professional life that's less well known is the enormous amount of help that he provided junior barristers. One colleague shared with me a story this week that encapsulated the way that Sandy interacted with junior colleagues. Chris was in Dubbo representing a defendant in a criminal trial. He was up late preparing to cross-examine a witness the next day. And just before he went to bed, he texted Sandy at about 11 p.m. and said, "I want to run something past you. Can we please chat briefly in the morning?" The next minute his phone rang with that familiar voice at the end, "Mate, what's happening?" They stayed up for the next hour, talking through exactly how to approach the cross-examination the next day. And so many of us can tell similar stories. I think that this sort of kindness was partly motivated by his belief in the traditions of the bar, but at a more fundamental level, it reflected his approach to friendship. Sandy took friendship extremely seriously. As one friend put it to me this week, he never took a friendship for granted. He was loyal, interested, energetic, trustworthy, sympathetic, and supportive. He would help you through the difficult patches and celebrate your wins as if they were his own, and he always remembered your birthday. In our friendship, I honestly can't recall a time when he didn't have time or wasn't interested. Of course, when you called him, he was often already on another call, so he'd say, "Call you right back." But then he would, and he would listen, and you could tell him anything. And in our case, we were lucky enough that our families became friends as well. So not only was he genuinely interested in what I was doing, but also what Carmen and the boys were doing. And he was always delighted in telling me what Jack and Alex and all the kids were up to. Of course, like any relationships, ours had its difficult moments. He struggled to accept my decision in 2015 to buy a Toyota Yaris. Without fail, whenever I called him from the Yaris, he could immediately detect the slightly tinny inferior quality of the Bluetooth and would say, "I'm sorry, I'm having difficulties hearing you." The repetition of such jokes and gentle barbs was part of the joy of friendship with Sandy. Particular expressions and sayings stuck, and they were repeated over and over again. It was like a song you both knew the words to. right up until the end, we continued to laugh at jokes and stories that we'd told each other many times before, probably long past the point where they were funny, but we continued to laugh about them. I don't know if Sandy ever took a personality test. Out of curiosity, I took an online test for him this week. Answering the questions is as if I was Sandy. It was surprisingly easy. The first question was, I try not to draw attention to myself, accurate or inaccurate? The next one, I make sure my work is finished on time, accurate or inaccurate? And on it went. Anyway, I completed the test and it confirmed my hunch. Sandy came out as 95% extroverted and 5% introverted, with high scores for intuition, feeling and perceiving. When Sandy got sick, he remained upbeat. Many of us would have curled up into a corner and retreated, but not Sandy. He lunched, he golfed, he kept busy. He watched trials in which he'd previously been briefed. He was optimistic about the time he had left, and he was brave and tenacious right until the end. It's difficult to imagine life at the bar, or indeed life in general, without Sandy. Phillip Street is quieter, and everything seems a bit more muted. But in typical Sandy fashion, he hasn't left us empty-handed. He's left us with a trove of stories and memories, as well as a shining example of how to be a terrific barrister and an even better friend.
Thank you, Declan. The wonderful thing, reading all the tributes about Sandy and hearing all the things that people say about him, is that he was just the same person, whether or not he was in high court with his colleagues at the bar, or with his mates from school, or his mates from uni, or his family. He was just as completely uninterested in being on time, just as outrageously funny, just as generous, just as kind. He was so memorable to so many people. I can't tell you the number of times I'd be somewhere, random street corners in New York or London, and someone would come up and say, "You're Sandy Dawson's brother, aren't you?" And then they would share some hilarious memory or encounter that they'd had with Sandy. I've received such wonderful messages from people with many of these stories over the last week and have much appreciated them. In just a minute, we're going to head outside and have some champagne. You can see the photo here and the photo on the back of the order of service of Sandy toasting us all. So that champagne's waiting, and I hope what we do is share our favourite Sandy stories and drink many toasts to him. But just before we do that, I'm going to finish the memorial with a final short tribute to Sandy. We've heard about skiing and how it was such an incredibly happy place for our family and for his family. Sandy, Katrina and I all loved getting our kids hooked on it too, hoping that if they couldn't afford a sport, they might come on holidays with us when they were older. Sandy was so proud of how his kids skied and just loved skiing with them. One of my favourite times was when, as Mum and Dad said, we were in Canada and we spent 6 weeks together. I was 19 and he was 20. We shared a room again for the first time since we were about 10 and would ski together every day and stay up talking most nights. So to finish, if you'll indulge me, I'm going to show you a video in just a minute that combines two of my favourite Sandy skiing memories. The first one comes from Steamboat, Colorado, where a few years ago, he and I went cat skiing. Robert Newlands, one of his friends from the bar, had generously invited us to join him and take two spots that he'd already booked and paid for. How could we say no? It was simply heaven, and my favourite day of skiing ever, with my favourite person to ski with. Sorry, Sammy. The second memory is as kids, Sandy and I used to love the James Bond ski chases. And when we were 11 and 12, we enacted our own version. Sandy, Katrina and I were in ski school in Switzerland with two rather unfriendly local Swiss-German kids who thought it was pretty funny that Katrina, at only 8, was falling over in the icy conditions, and they skied past her rather than helping her up. So our protective big brother instincts kicked in. After only we were allowed to laugh at her when she fell over. We had nicknamed these kids the Ooshton Easton's, because when they spoke, all we heard was Ooshton Easton, Blushton, Blushton. So Sandy leant over to me and said, "We need to take the Ooshton Easton's out." So humming the James Bond theme, as loud as we could, we raced down the catwalks in full tuck mode and shoulder charged them into the side of the mountain, creating a full yard sale of all their skis and poles. They became much more supportive to Katrina after that. So the video you're about to see is from Steamboat with Carly Simon's James Bond theme. Say it all.
Does it half as good as